Welcome to our first Pep Talk. Today we have the honor to have Mr. Solomon Frank from Micronesia. And he will be speaking today about the global seaweed market, and he will tell us a little bit more about his country and his culture. And thank you, Sol, for being here.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Why don't you start telling us a little bit more about Micronesia, what's his history behind it, this country in the Pacific Islands, not many people know about it. So just tell us a little bit more about it, some issues and challenges, either being economic, political, social, that you know of.
Just for some location, Micronesia is placed between Hawaii and Australia, a mass of about a million square miles. It's just west of the Marshall Islands and just east of Guam. So Guam has been in the political news recently, and so some people might be familiar with that. So just east of Guam is where Micronesia is. As far as our history is concerned, one notable thing that happened was the Salter Nation or the Salter time, and that was when they created this magnificent rock formations out in the Pacific Ocean. It's kind of called like the Venice of the Pacific.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's called Nan Madol, and that was kind of a city that was built with canals and things, and it was kind of a tribute to the turtle gods at the time. So. Lots of sea turtles come around, so that's kind of a prevalent thing that's happened there. And actually, in the 1800s, my specific atoll went under attack by some pirates that were came from Australia. We don't know their origins, actually, but they made their way out there and took some of our turtle shells, and so that's kind of in our history. So we do have some German and some other type of blood in us at this time, but... Then during World War II, the Japanese kind of island hopped their way to Hawaii, and so one of our islands was part of that, and so there's some military artillery that's still out there and left behind during World War II. After World War II, around 1975 and the 80s range is when we kind of declared our independence, and the Kofan Nations were assembled, which is the Marshall Islands, Republic of Palau, Federation of Micronesia, yes. And so that was the most recent thing. Now, in 2023, there's gonna be a renegotiation of the Kofan Nations, and it's gonna be a really trying time coming up, and so we're gonna see how that helps us.
So lots of history behind Micronesia, as you guys can see, going back to hundreds of years, and a mixture of cultures.
Without a doubt, thanks to trading and stuff in the South Pacific, and so.
Okay.
Most of our issues are from being so remote at this time, so.
So the location, you will say, is like one of the biggest issues, maybe transportation?
Yeah, and there's been routes that have been tried before and that have gone away, and I think the lack of trade is something that they're missing that could help them out.
Okay, so
maybe we'll get into that a little bit.
We'll get into it. So, thank you for that, Sol, for that background. Yeah. As you guys can see, a rich history in Micronesia, and we have someone here at Thunderbird helping us to learn more about it. Well, let's jump into the topic of the global seaweed market. So, why does this topic interest you? How did you learn about this, and where do you think now it's going?
Well, I grew up in the Pacific Northwest in Oregon. My father was actually came over in 1988, I believe. And so I grew up very green, if you will. And so sustainability is something that's very, very interest in mine. And example of that, what you've actually helped me with is Thunder Leaf. We've kind of done that. And I kind of got my green thumb going. I did some planting projects in Oregon. And I enjoy being able to plant things. And so seaweed is very magnificent in the sense that it takes CO2 from the air and filters it and brings it out, right, and cleans the air. Right now, seaweed is not very prevalent on the west coast of the US because there's not very many reefs or anything that can stop the seaweed or stop storms from taking the seaweed away.
Okay.
When they try and grow some things, that's a issue that they have, is that when they're trying to do research and things, they will grow something and then it will end up being taken away by the storm. And why I think we have an advantage out there is that we do have atolls in which that we can plant seaweed to the ocean and be able to use the atolls as a safe barrier, as small fish do now.
Global seaweed market, based on, you know, some readings that we did, it's booming.
Yeah.
It's becoming a $1 billion industry. Mm-hmm. Not only because of the health benefits, but because of many other usage for, I mean, they use it for producing other stuff and medicines as well. Mm-hmm. But also for those, for our vegan friends out there, the paleo diet, mm-hmm. it's an essential, a replacement for salt. So how do you think an innovation like this, innovative practice like this, would benefit the region of Micronesia? How will this increase, you know, maybe trade for the region, or what do you think will be more? Some benefits of implementing some of these innovative practices?
There's three types of seaweed. There's red, there's, I believe it's purple and green. And these three types of seaweed have different features. So much like different crops in the U.S., they have commodity crops, and they also have crops that are used as the trade themselves. So like apples are used to eat as apples, mm-hmm. whereas corn can be produced as corn, but also to make high fructose corn syrup. The seaweeds do the same. So one, some are edible and others can be used for cosmetics amongst other things, which is great. What's good about this for the economy in Micronesia, but also for just the region, I think one thing that they're lacking is the education for like biology and chemistry and things like that. And those are major things in which we can develop potentially more sustainable ways with seaweed to make a better future for the world itself. Seaweed, again, is so easy to grow. It's put in the water and the nutrients are in the water. So really it's the sun's doing the work and the water's doing the work. You just gotta make sure that it's clean.
You mentioned education, which is a big part in any economy. So how's the education like in such a small country like Micronesia, or even just, you know, the islands around it?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked. Actually, my mother has been a great influence on me, and she's always been about giving back. She actually married another islander, not my father, but he's very strong about giving back as well. And we've actually brought many Micronesian students over and family members to be able to come to America and also to try their education and try and go to college and things, because we believe that the college system here is better than out there. And that has become true because some of the students that we've brought, they're not able to succeed here. And I think that that's a direct correlation, that the education there is not adequate enough to be able to transfer to the U.S. Obviously, maybe the U.S. might be the gold standard from what we see, but Micronesia is behind that. So at least to get there, we need to improve. I think if we bring things that need to be researched, at least biologically and for chemistry, mm-hmm. That opportunity can just allow people to go into other areas as well. You know what I mean? Once we bring in some money to do better education, then more will come in. We can only hope.
Yeah, absolutely. What do you think, besides biology, what do you think are some practices that will help this education like develop in the region in order to implement those, some of these practices that will increase trade and, you know, exports, I mean, just imports, whatever, you know, gets the region going a little more?
Well, obviously there's going to be some capital that's going to be needed in order to start these farms and things. And so proper education on how to acquire these funds in order to make these crops. Because essentially, the essence of all the seaweed is to give people an opportunity to have an economic income. Because right now, the islands are kind of becoming deserted because people want to go and have an income and buy, be able to purchase things. And at this time, they're not able to. Some parents would like to send their kids to school as well, and maybe a better school. And just by providing an economic opportunity for them, it would be great. As money flows down the chain of the family, it will hopefully help them out.
A country like Micronesia shows you how there's so many people out there in the world that can be, you know, left behind, mm-hmm. and that there's so much opportunity for growth and development, but that we haven't reached out to just either because lack of opportunity or just because even a lack of knowledge of the region. So it's very important to start developing these, what they call bottom of the pyramid, to start growing. Any other things that you would like to talk about Micronesia? So any social challenges that you see, from your time of going back there after being here in the U.S. for so long, any political issues?
The biggest thing is just the treaty that's coming up. There has been some instability with the last treaty. Some of the funding may have been lack, and that could be on part of the funding, and it also may be part of the country itself not maybe using the funds correctly and then making them deplete. Obviously, we're trying to boost the economy and things, but people continue to leave because there's not opportunities out there at this time. And I think that if people have something to go to, they might stick around a little longer than they are, or at least return. I know that many people are here in the U.S. and they're not living on the islands, we'll say that. And so I don't know if their quality of living is better, but I'll say that the
like the beach, you know?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And I'm pretty sure they do too, but they think that they're in a spot where they have to work in order to provide. And I mean, you do, but if you can work from your original home, why wouldn't you stay?
Yeah, it goes from a survival standpoint to a consumption standpoint.
Exactly.
In the U.S., where you're just too worried about what you're going to consume the next day rather than what you're going to eat
exactly.
Your kids' place.
And that's another thing, is that once the seaweed market develops itself, it can create its own economy. Like, a sustainable goal would be awesome if Micronesia could be like a zero emissions country. I know that there's a few out there right now, and that would be like a sustainable goal that I would have, just because like we're cleaning the air already, but like seaweed might put us over the top to make us a zero emissions country. And you know, maybe it might not have an economic benefit, but it would definitely have a social impact on people. Like, hey, you know, we're doing our part, and we got to do our part because, you know, with sea level rising, we got to set the example.
How's the electricity like in Micronesia? So you think some renewable energy will benefit? I mean, obviously being in, you know, in the Pacific Islands, there's so many opportunities for what, you know, you've seen the wind, solar power generated in the sea, solar plants that are being generated in the Philippines as well, all over China. I mean, that region is growing a lot in terms of renewable energy. How's the energy like in Micronesia?
Yeah, so the last time I was there was 2015, and they had some rolling blackouts at times, which is, I mean, I can understand because it's tough out there, and I don't think wind would be necessarily something that I would like, wind power, just because they're kind of eyesores. I mean, you have a beautiful island. I don't think you want to put a white palm tree up, you know what I mean? But I think we have so much ocean out there in the currents that there's something to do with that. And again, like I had mentioned earlier about using biology and chemistry to be able to study these seaweed and stuff, but if you have infrastructure in place to study those things, you can also expand into other things, which could be renewable energies. I'm convinced that the currents can help us out with energy because they're constantly moving. We're not trying to stop them from moving, we're just trying to harness how they're moving, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, this is very helpful, so honestly, guys, a little, you know, knowledge on the global seaweed market, on the Pacific Islands, Micronesia in specific, what are some of the economic struggles and challenges that these people in such tiny islands. Tell us a personal story, a personal experience, memory that you have with your family, friends, just when the time that you've been back in Micronesia, something that, you know, comes to your mind every time that you think of Micronesia.
Yeah, so this one night we go night fishing, and I'm carrying the bucket because my other cousins are better fishermen than me, and we're using spears. So when it's low tide, the water's low enough so you can walk on the reefs and stuff. And so that's what we were doing at night. And the fish kind of sleep underneath the coral, and so they're not moving. And so you can just pick them off. And so my cousins were going so fast that I couldn't even keep up with them. And so they're catching fish, and I'm running with the bucket. And they got those sea urchins that are on the ground. I'm scared to step on them, so I'm just trying to keep up. But it was a great night. We ended up catching like 30 fish. And so ended up feeding the family, so that's always a good time.
And there's so many risks to do that at night that they don't even like think about, right?
No, and and their eyes are so good that they can see and run at the same time. It's amazing. So
which is crazy.
Yeah,
they can be great athletes.
Yeah, they can.
That's awesome. So I mean, you told me so many stories about Micronesia. I learned so much from these guys. I want you to talk a little more about Tony DeBrun. He's a diplomat from the Marshall Islands, who unfortunately passed out in August of 2017, but he helped organize the Marshall Islands independence from the United States.
Yeah.
Correct? You can talk to
him. Yeah, so the Marshall Islands were kind of the breeding ground for some of the nuclear testing that was happening back in during World War II. And so he was on the forefront of getting the independence, but also getting some back pay for all the damages that caused to the people in the area. One of the things that he did most notably recently is he was a part of the Paris Climate Change Agreement, and he was a great fight on climate change, and he's kind of had influence on me. I was fortunate enough to meet him back in 2015. Found out he was actually my uncle, but he was doing some diplomatic work there in Pohnpei at the time, and he kind of helped us get the ship back to bring us some more supplies. So he really influenced me in the sense that this is something that I would like to pursue and try and help out the islands, because I mean, you can always work here in the U.S. and just have a good time, you know, and make some decent money, but at the end of the day, I'm trying to help out the people, and that's something that really stuck with me, and that's something that he did, so that's what I'm trying to fulfill.
Which is awesome, Saul, and I mean, like I said, I've learned so much from this guy. I know you're gonna go far in life, man, and I really hope you can do more for all these people that are in need, and that they just need an opportunity rather than just something given to them.
Exactly. And yeah, we're in class together. We talk about Bob Miranda's class, and he says, like, you don't always teach or give a man a fish, but you can't. I mean, it'd be better to teach him how to fish.
And it applies perfectly.
Yeah, it applies perfectly. Now, we're not fishing fish, but we're fishing seaweed.
That's awesome. Well, thank you, Saul. Before we leave, I want to say, you know, this guy has created many amazing experiences, not only for himself, but for many other people here on campus. As he mentioned earlier, he was a mastermind behind the Thunderleaf camp. I don't know if you've seen it. If you haven't, please go follow the Thunderleaf Facebook page or see the pictures that have been uploaded on our Thunderbird website. It's the first sustainable garden on campus. It has an amazing Thunderbird shape that he created. So thank you for all these experiences that you've had for us. A great cook, too, by the way. And I'm going to end up the discussion with a quote from Mr. DeBrum that says, "We are not just trying to save our islands, we are trying to save the entire world. If the Pacific Islands disappear, then it will be too late for everyone else." Thank you, Saul.
Thank you, Shane. Appreciate you, man.
Thank you, guys. First pep talk.
Thank you.